I say, then, mortification is not the present business of unregenerate men. God calls them not to it as yet. Conversion is their work, the conversion of the whole soul, not the mortification of this or that particular lust. You would laugh at a man that you should see setting up a great fabric, and never take any care for a foundation, especially if you should see him so foolish as that, having 1,000 experiences that what he built one day fell down another, he would yet continue in the same course. So it is with convinced persons, though they plainly see that what ground they get against sin one day they lose another, yet they will go on in the same road, still without inquiring where the destructive flaw in their progress lies. When the Jews, upon conviction of their sin, were cut to the heart and cried out, "What shall we do?" Acts 2:37. What does Peter direct them to do? Does he bid them go and mortify their pride, wrath, malice, cruelty, and the like? No, he knew that was not their present work, but he calls them to conversion and faith in Christ in general. Verse 38. Let the soul be first thoroughly converted, and then, quote, looking on him whom they had pierced, unquote, Zechariah 12:10 and John 19:37. Humiliation and mortification will ensue. Thus, when John came to preach repentance and conversion, he said, quote, the axe is now laid to the root of the tree, unquote, Matthew 3:10. The Pharisees had been laying heavy burdens, imposing tedious duties, and rigid means of mortification, in fastings, washings, and the like, all in vain. Says John, quote, the doctrine of conversion is for you. The axe in my hand is laid to the root. And our Savior tells us what is to be done in this case. Quote, do men gather grapes of thorns? Unquote, Matthew 7:16. But suppose a thorn be well pruned and cut, and have pains taken with him. Yea, but he will never bear figs, verses 17-18. Also James 3:12. It cannot be but every tree will bring forth fruit according to its own kind. What is then to be done? He tells us, quote, make the tree good, and his fruit will be good, unquote, Matthew 12:33. The root must be dealt with, the nature of the tree changed, or no good fruit will be brought forth. This is that I aim at. Unless a man be regenerate, unless he be a believer, all attempts that he can make for mortification, be they never so specious and promising, all means he can use, let him follow them with never so much diligence, earnestness, watchfulness, and intention of mind and spirit, are to no purpose. In vain shall he use many remedies, he shall not be healed. Yea, there are sundry desperate evils attending an endeavor in convinced persons that are no more but so to perform this duty. The mind and soul is taken up about that which is not the man's proper business, and so he is diverted from that which is so. God lays hold by his word and judgments on some sin in him, galls his conscience, disquiets his heart, deprives him of his rest. Now other diversions will not serve his turn. He must apply himself to the work before him, the business in hand being to awaken the whole man unto a consideration of the state and condition wherein he is, that he might be brought home to God. Instead hereof he sets himself to mortify the sin that galls him, which is a pure issue of self-love, to be freed from his trouble, and not at all to the work he is called unto, and so is diverted from it. They set themselves to a relinquishment of sin, but not in that manner, by universal conversion, as God called for it. Thus are men diverted from coming unto God by the most glorious ways that they can fix upon, to come to him by. And this is one of the most common deceits whereby men ruin their souls. What do men do? What oftentimes are they directed unto, when their consciences are galled by sin and disquietment from the Lord, who has laid hold upon them? Is not a relinquishment of the sin, as to practice, that they are, in some fruits of it, perplexed with, and making head against it, the sum of what they apply themselves unto? And is not the gospel end of their convictions lost thereby? Here men abide and perish. All acceptable obedience is called a proceeding according unto rule. Galatians 6:16. It is a canonical or regular obedience. As letters in the alphabet heaped together signifying nothing unless they are disposed into their proper order, no more do our duties without this disposal. That they be so is the great duty of the mind, and which with all diligence it is to attend unto. Walk circumspectly, Ephesians 5:15. Exactly, accurately, that is, diligently, in all things. Take heed to the rule of what you do. We walk in duties, but we walk circumspectly in this attention of the mind. As to the principle of it, namely, that it be done in faith, and therein by an actual derivation of strength from Christ, without whom we can do nothing, John 15:5. It is not enough that the person be a believer, though that be necessary unto every good work, Ephesians 2:10, but also that faith be peculiarly acted in every duty that we do. For our whole obedience is the obedience of faith, Romans 1:5, that is, which the doctrine of faith requires, and which the grace of faith bears or brings forth. So Christ is expressly said to be our life, Colossians 3:4, our spiritual life, that is, the spring, author, and cause of it. Now, as in life natural, no vital act can be performed but by the actual operation of the principle of life itself, so, in life spiritual, no spiritually vital act, that is, no duty acceptable to God, can be performed but by the actual working of Christ, who is our life. And this is no other way derived unto us but by faith, whence, says the Apostle, quote, Christ lives in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith of the Son of God, unquote. Galatians 2:20. Not only was Christ his life, a living principle unto him, but he led a life, that is, discharged vital actions in all duties of holiness and obedience, by the faith of the Son of God, or in him, deriving supplies of grace and strength from him thereby. This, therefore, ought a believer diligently to attend unto, namely, that everything he does to God be done in the strength of Christ, which wherein it consists, ought diligently to be inquired into by all who intend to walk with God. In this respect, unto rule, the manner of the performance of every duty is to be regarded. Now, there are two things in the manner of the performance of any duty which a believer, who is trusted with spiritual light, ought to attend unto. First, that it be done in the way and by the means that God has prescribed with respect unto the outward manner of its performance, and this is especially to be regarded in duties of the worship of God. The matter and outward manner whereof do both equally fall under his command. If this be not regarded, the whole duty is vitiated. I speak not of them who suffer themselves to be deluded by the deceitfulness of sin, utterly to disregard the rule of the word in such things, and to worship God according to their own imaginations, but of them principally who, although they in general profess to do nothing but what God requires, and as he requires it, yet do not diligently attend to the rule, to make the authority of God to be the sole cause and reason both of what they do and of the manner of the performance of it. And this is the reason that God so often calls on his people to consider diligently and wisely, that they may do all according as he had commanded. Second, the affections of the heart and mind in duties belong to the performance of them in the inward manner. The prescriptions and commands of God for attendance hereunto are innumerable, and the want hereof renders every duty an abomination unto him. A sacrifice without a heart, without salt, without fire, of what value is it? No more are duties without spiritual affections. And herein is the mind to keep the charge of God, to see that the heart which he requires be tendered to him. And we find also that God requires special affections to accompany special duties. Quote, "He that gives with cheerfulness," unquote, which, if they are not attended unto, the whole is lost. Romans 12:8, 1 Corinthians 9:7. The mind is to attend unto the ends of duties, and therein principally the glory of God in Christ. Several other ends will sin and self impose upon our duties. Especially, too, it will press hard upon with us. First, satisfaction of our convictions and consciences. Secondly, the praise of men. For self-righteousness and ostentation are the main ends of men that are fallen off from God in all moral duties whatsoever. In their sins they endeavor for to satisfy their lusts. In their duties, their conviction and pride. These the mind of a believer is diligently to watch against, and to keep up in all a single eye to the glory of God, as that which answers the great and general rule of all our obedience. Quote, "Whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God," unquote. 1 Corinthians 10:31. These and the like things, I say, which are commonly spoken unto, is the mind of a believer obliged to attend diligently and constantly unto, with respect unto all the particular duties of our walking before God.